called The Staff. It's basically 5 lines and 4 spaces. So take a look at the image here. 5 lines and 4 spaces. Each line or space represents a different note. One thing to note, it is very important right now to make the correlation or see the relationship between the lines and spaces on your staff and how they relate to the keyboard. So if we're going from one line to the next space to the next line, that is one white key to the next white key because there's no space in between. It's just stepping up and down the staff. So the keyboard has 88 keys. That is a lot of notes. That is a lot of notes. And like we said previously, our staff has 5 lines and 4 spaces. So how do we fit all of those notes, 88 notes to be exact, into 5 lines and 4 spaces? Well, the short answer is we don't. We have symbols that we put right next to our staff that shows us which portion of the keyboard the notes are representing. These symbols are called clefs. So there are quite a few different clefs within written music, but fortunately, as a pianist, you need to know 2 and only 2. We call them our bass clef and our treble clef. The symbols are pretty synonymous with music, so even if you've never read sheet music before, I'm sure you've seen a picture of a treble clef and a bass clef. The first clef we're going to take a look at is the treble clef. So the treble clef actually used to be called a G clef because it looked like an old English style G a long time ago. But actually, it's still called a G clef now because where the little squiggle part of the symbol lines up with the second to last line, second to the bottom line on the staff, is where G above our middle C is. So it's called a G clef now because this is where our G is. And this is a great first note to learn. Like if you're trying to find the other notes, an easy thing to do is counting up or down. So if we were to go to, let's say, the space right above that G, remember it's the very next part on our graph, on our staff. So that note is going to be an A. If we go to the next note, that would be a B. Now if we go back to our G, right, and we were to go lower, all you got to do is take your alphabet in reverse. So if I go one note below that G, the note before that is going to be an F. And if I go from that space to the line right below that, that note is going to be E. So on and so forth. So this is a great first thing to learn on the treble clef, where treble clef G is. Now, there's still a lot of ground to cover on the treble clef. So sometimes for students, counting all the way up and down isn't the fastest way to find the notes. It's really helpful at first though, so make sure that you do it. However, a good way to kind of see the graph from a more further back perspective is to use our mnemonic devices, just like sayings, to remember all of our lines or all of our spaces. So usually I just start students with 1 on the treble clef, and that is for all of the spaces. So from the bottom space to the top space, remember we have 4 spaces, it spells the word face, F, A, C, and E. And if you take a look at that G line, you can see why, because you know, the note, the space right below the G is an F, and then the space right above that is an A. And then because we're skipping to the next space, there's a note in between. Look at the keyboard. A to C, there's a skip, and then C to E, there's also a skip. So remember, for your treble clef, face for the space. Face for the space, all right? F, A, C, E from the bottom to the top. And now you know all the notes on the treble clef. You're like, well, what about the lines? You can fill them in, right? Let's take a look at the space between, or the line between C and E, okay? What letter in your alphabet is between C and E? A, B, C, D, E. Pretty simple. The more you get used to looking at your staff like this, eventually you're just gonna memorize your notes. But the mnemonic devices are crucial in the beginning to memorizing your graph. Now for our second clef. Our second clef, as previously mentioned, is the bass clef. So this clef used to look like an old English F back in the day. So we had our treble clef, the G clef, and now we have our bass clef, the F clef. But it's also called an F clef because, see where those 2 dots are? The line in between the 2 dots on the bass clef is the F below middle C. So this is the main reason that now we call it an F clef, because the bass clef doesn't really look like an F anymore. So just like with the treble clef, we can apply the same concept of moving up or down by step and its relationship to our alphabet, right? So if we're starting with that F, the two dots right there and the line between, if we go up a step, that's gonna be a G, right? Next letter. If we go back to the F and we go down a step, it's gonna be E. Pretty simple, right? You can just apply that to the whole staff. Now, just like with the treble clef, how we learned face for the spaces, we are gonna learn another mnemonic device for the spaces on the bass clef. So starting from the bottom, we go A, next space is C, next space is E, and the next space is a G. So the saying that we use here is all cows eat grass. One more time, all cows eat grass. Pretty simple, should be easy to remember. Think about a little cute cow just gnawing on some grass. I don't like to do sayings for the lines. There are sayings for the lines, but instead I like using one saying for spaces for each clef and then having students be able to count between. So it kind of works on your understanding of the clef as a whole, understanding your sayings, and then this concept of moving by step, which is really, really important to seeing the relationship between your written music and your keyboard. All right, so we just learned our two clefs. Now, if you look at the two clefs with treble clef and a bass clef, that still doesn't cover 88 notes, not even close. So what do we do to account for notes that go beyond the staff, right, above or below? So let's take a look at our treble clef to see what happens. So if we go from our G, right, remember treble clef G, that second line sit to the bottom, and then we just proceed up by step, right? So the next note above G is gonna be an A, the line above that is a B, the space above that is a C, the line above that is a D, the space above that is an E, the line above that is an F, and then resting on the space on top of the staff is a G. Now, our next note is gonna be an A, but what do we do to show that it's there? We use what's called a ledger line. So we would put that A, and then we just put a little line through the A. Imagine it as a continuation of the staff. So you can continue on with ledger lines like four or five up if you really wanted to. So if we were to continue on from that A, the next note would be a B. So we draw another ledger line right next to it, and then we put the B on top of that line. So it's still showing the line and space relationship without making it super, super cluttered. Because could you imagine if your staff was like 10 lines or 20 lines to fit all the notes? Really hard to look at, and it would be really hard to print more than one like line of music on the page. So that's why we have the five lines, four spaces, and our ledger lines. Now we need to put our two staves together to make piano music, right? Because we had our treble clef put on one stave, we had our bass clef put on another stave, but they need to be together to show both hands what to do at the same time. So this is what makes our piano music. These two staves coming together are called the grand staff. So we have one staff, we have another staff, they come together, and it is grand, the grand staff. Now, we have five lines in one, and obviously five lines in the other. To show the relationship between the two, I want you to imagine an 11th line in the middle of those two groups of five. However, in written sheet music, this is used as a ledger line. Right, because if there's no division between our treble clef and bass clef, it literally just looks like lines on a page. So that middle dividing or 11th line right there is going to represent middle C. This is so important because it tells you what note to play, right? Because when you look at the keyboard, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 8 C's right there. That's a lot of C's. So knowing where our middle C is going to tell you exactly which notes to play on our keyboard. All right, and that's it. You literally learned all the notes that are on the grand staff now. All you have to do is memorize them. So this is really similar to, you know, think about when you first learned multiplication, right? When you did 3 times 3, you had to draw the three little groups of three dots on the page and you count them up and you're like, this is 9, yay! And eventually you memorized it, right? Just like how you memorize all your times tables. Written music is the same thing. The cool thing about written music is that, one, it follows the graph pattern, so it always looks the same. And also, there's only 7 notes, just 7. So paying careful attention to whether you're reading a treble clef or bass clef and then which line or space you're looking at is all you need to do. The more you use the devices, so remember for our treble clef, for our spaces, it's face, and for our bass clef, for the spaces, all cows eat grass. You're gonna orient yourself better on the keyboard, but eventually you're just gonna memorize it. So you're gonna see a note, and you'll be like, that's an F, that's an E, that's a D. It just takes repetition. That's all it is. So the more you can do this, the more apps that you can try on your phone, the more written music that you have to look at, the easier it is going to be. The learning curve is always a little bit steep at first, so do not be discouraged. Just chip away at it a little bit every day, and I promise you're gonna get it in no time. All right, this video hopefully taught you how to read sheet music. I really hope it was helpful. Let me know in the comments below if you use any other things to help you read your music, such as different mnemonic devices. One time I had a student learn it entirely with Pokemon names. He just used the names of different Pokemon monsters to help him remember his lines and spaces, but you know what? It worked. He did an awesome job with it. So if you get creative with it, let me know what you thought of. And, you know, as always, good luck with the practice. If you appreciate the content, definitely check a link to the shop below. I'm wearing one of the shirts right now. And stay powerful, y'all.